Hi, welcome back to the course that is intellectual property rights. Last two lectures remaining, out of which today we'll discuss the topic that is International Treaty on Plant Genetic Resources for Food and Agriculture. Okay, with respect to our final theory examination, it is one of the important topic. So be prepared for your examination purpose. In this topic, we'll discuss about what is this treaty means, what are the purposes, aims, obligations, and some important points of the treaty. And as we discussed earlier, in our subject, that is IPR, so many agreements, treaties, laws are there, which are mainly ensuring and security of nature and also food to the increasing population. So, as we know, Indian population or world population is increasing, and as compared to that, our land is limited or it's not getting increased. So what is happening? Many crops are there which are mainly used, that is 4 to 5 different crops are there, that is wheat is there, rice is there, many cereals are also there, which are mainly used for this increased population. And as we know, land is limited or it's constant, even it is decreasing. So it is necessary to increase the yield of that particular crops. And when we are increasing the production or yield of the crop, we are using number of fertilizers, chemicals, and also improved varieties of the crops. While this improving of the varieties of crops, there is an hazardous to some other species of the plants, crops. So it is necessary to have some guidelines, directives with respect to the use of these genetic resources which are available in the nature and agriculture. Okay, so this particular treaty is there, and the main aim of the treaty, that is the conservation and sustainable use of plant genetic resources for food and agriculture, and are key ensuring that the world will produce enough food to feed its growing population in the future. Okay, so this increased population, and which is continuously increasing, there is a necessity of directives, some principles, so that we are able to feed the nation, we are able to feed the world population. So in this treaty, there is an important historical background is there, in which in 1983 the Commission on Genetic Resources for Food and Agriculture was established, and the voluntary international undertaking on plant genetic resources was adopted. Okay, so it's one of the voluntary action in which it is decided about the formation of this type of the treaty. Then in 1996, with the adoption of the Global Plan of Action at the Leipzig International Technical Conference on Plant Genetic Resources. Okay, so it's an adaptation of the Global Plan in 1996. Then International Treaty on Plant Genetic Resources for Food and Agriculture adopted in 2001. Okay, so initially from 1983 to 2001, the basic ideas the things to be included. All these type of the discussions were held, and in between adoption of different types of the plans and treaties were there. And in 2001, this particular international treaty on plant genetic resources for food and agriculture adopted. The treaty entered into the force on 29th of June 2004. As we earlier also discussed, so many treaties are there. When it got formed and when it come into force or it got implemented, it takes some time for development of the structures, development of infrastructures for the necessary implementations. So here, remember all these two dates, that is adoption of the international treaty on plant genetic resources and food and agriculture is 2001, while it is entered in force or implemented in 29th June 2004. Then some important points are there in which some general applications are there, which should be followed by the members or parties of this treaty, in which each contracting party shall ensure the conformity of its laws, regulations, and procedures with its obligations as provided in this treaty. Okay, so some directives and principles are given for each member of the treaty, and they will have to follow all these instructions, directives as per the treaty. Then conservation, exploration, collection, characterization, evaluation, and documentation of plant genetic resources for food and agriculture. Even so many new varieties are coming up from different research institutes. Many are there which are it's present in nature, which are having useful characteristics, and still which are not studied. Okay, so day by day, these particular varieties or species are studied and recorded. Their characterization is also takes place, and all these things are the part of the treaty in which we need to document it, characterize it, collection, exploration, and conservation. Conservation is one of the important point. As we know, many natural resources which are freely available, which are explored in unlimited matter, or there is no basic limitations. So conservation is very much important nowadays. Then sustainable use of plant genetic resources. Pursuing fair agriculture policies that promote as appropriate the development and maintenance of the diverse farming systems that enhance the sustainable use of agricultural, biological diversity, and other natural resources. Okay, so it's again, as we discussed in the Convention on Biological Diversity, sustainable use of plant genetic resources. Okay, same point is here also. And Convention on Biological Diversity is nothing but the part of this treaty. Then some articles are there which are playing an important role, in which Article 7, that is national commitment and international cooperation. Okay, so in the number of organizations or institutions which are playing an important role in intellectual property rights, there is a national commitments of the parties and members for the cooperation in between parties with respect to the diverse range of the points. Okay, whatever it may be related to the treaty. Then article number 8 is there, that is technical assistance. Now the contracting parties agree to promote the provision of technical assistance to the contracting parties. So it's also one of the important point. As we know, in India, there is a biodiversity, there is a specific species of plants and animal which may not be available in the other part of the world. Or in Canada or Britain, some varieties or species are there which are not available in India. Okay, and any country or any party is willing to study on that particular species which are not yet done. In these particular cases, there should be a technical assistant between the parties, and which is very much useful for the coming days or the future of next generations. So this is also one of the important point which is included in the treaty. Then moving on to the next slide, the objectives of this treaty are conservation and sustainable use of plant genetic resources for food and agriculture. Okay, in the name itself, it's there. Okay, aim or objectives. So conservation is one of the important point. Then second one is the fair and equitable sharing of the benefit arising out from use of plant genetic resources. Okay, this is nothing but the important point with respect to the traditional knowledge. Okay, as we know, many unstudied material species are there, and their uses are also there, in which are explored by the commercial people's companies, and the main person which is involved in that research or that traditional knowledge is not getting any benefits. Okay, so this is also one of the important point, that is the fair and equitable sharing. Okay, whatever benefits are there, not only the economical benefit but others also. Okay, any patent is there or any other properties are there, all those should be equitably shared between the people who are related to or who are involved in this particular. Is also one of the important point. Then next is there, that is main provisions. Okay, mainly four provisions are there in this international treaty. First one is there, that is multilateral system. Okay, so here in the multilateral system, the treaty truly innovative solution to access and benefit sharing. The multilateral system puts 64 of our most important crops. Okay, so the crops which are we are using, it may be cereals, pulses, or any other. Okay, all these particular crops are there, out of which 64 are included, and which are the 80% of the food driven from the plants. Okay, and as it is including this 80% of the crops from which we are getting the food, so it is also having and a lot of information, genetic resources with the treaty, or which is a part of the treaty, and these resources can be freely available to the potential users of the treaty's ratifying nation for the same uses. Means what? So many 80% of the crops are there, in which so many researchers are going on, and they are having different properties. So if so many persons, institutions or organizations from the number of parties getting the access to such crops, then it will be beneficial to number of parties or so many members, and it is indirectly useful to the community. Then access and benefit sharing, as we discussed earlier, access and benefit sharing is nothing but the whatever genetic material, genetic pool is there, genetic resources are there of the crops which are the resources for the food are included, and they are having access for the study purpose or any other purpose. But the thing is that benefits which are arising from such things, which will be equally distributed, or the benefits should be shared between the parties, between the members. Okay, those who access genetic materials throughout the multilateral system agree to share and any benefits from their use through four benefit sharing mechanisms established by the treaty. So what is important point, that is treaty have some directives principles with respect to the benefit sharing also. And through that particular way, the countries or parties which are included, which are getting access, they have to distribute among the parties which are involved in this. Okay, that is access and benefit sharing. Then next is there, that is farmers' right. Now farmers' right are also there. One important is there, that is PPV FRA, protection of plant varieties and farmers' right, in which we are going to study in depth in our last lecture. So here the treaty recognizes the enormous contribution of the farmers have made to ongoing development of the world's wealth and plant genetic resources. Okay, mainly so many new varieties are also there which are developed by the farmers itself. Okay, which may be the variation found by variation which is observed by the farmers. They will multiply that variation and that variety may be released. Okay, so this is just example, but like this, so many new varieties and also lot of traditional knowledge is there with respect to new crop varieties and useful characteristics of the crops and plants. So all these are the properties of the farmers. Okay, and here this traditional knowledge or whatever it may be, it can be protected and they will also have the share of the benefits for their traditional knowledge and new improvement in the crop varieties. And last one is there, that is sustainable use. Okay, sustainable use, that is most of the world food come from our four main crops, that is rice, wheat, maize and potatoes are also there. So here, other than these four main crops, so many other crops are also there. Millets are there, and mainly which are having, or which we have to take in very small quantity, and they are having nutritional values. Okay, so the treaty willing to increase the use of these minor crops or the nutritional crops also with addition to this main crop. Okay, so it's also nothing but the sustainable use in some manner. So all these particular are the functions, aims and important points with respect to the International Treaty on Plant Genetic Resources for Food and Agriculture. Okay, so we'll stop here. In the next lecture, we'll discuss about PPV FRA, that is Protection of Plant Varieties and Farmers' Right.